Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, Dow Chemical Company, the Mobile Corporation, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Atlantic Richfield, and the Friends of Firing Line.
Our principal guests today are expert in what is happening in Nicaragua. Dr. Manuel Alzugaray is from the private sector. Otto Reich is a government official. Both endorse the need for U.S. activity in Nicaragua in opposition to the Sandinistas. But we hope in the course of the hour to settle a few questions that continue to dog us. Dr. Alzugaray was studying medicine in Havana when Castro took over Cuba. He declined to join the Communist Party and was detained. He escaped finally and reached America in 1962, where he joined the army. Upon being discharged, he went to Spain to finish his medical work, returning to New York in 1970 as an orthopedic surgeon, and subsequently settling in Miami, where he became active in the anti-communist Hispanic community. In 1983, he and a half dozen other doctors volunteered to form a small field hospital in Honduras to care for the wounded Contras. I assume, subject to correction, that our non-military congressional aid to the Contras goes to such as Dr. Alzugaray. Otto Reich, as it happens, was also born in Cuba. He studied at the University of North Carolina and then at Georgetown, where he took an advanced degree, going on to work for the Council of the Americas, a private association of U.S. companies with interest in Latin America. He became then Assistant Administrator of the U.S. Agency for International Development, and as such was the principal official in the U.S. government charged with directing U.S. economic support for that part of the world. 2 years ago, he became Coordinator of Public Diplomacy for Latin America and the Caribbean with the rank of Ambassador. Mr. Michael Kinsley, the editor of The New Republic, is our well-known examiner. More about him in due course. Now, I propose to plant some very direct questions and ask these gentlemen to comment on them. The first, and I call on Mr. Reich to answer this, is how do you explain President Reagan's statement that our goal is not to overthrow the Sandinista government when simultaneously he tells us he wants democracy in Nicaragua and that democracy under the Sandinistas is impossible?
Well, U.S. policy toward Nicaragua, the president has several times stated, consists of four goals. One is the establishment of the democracy that the Sandinistas themselves and the other people who overthrew Somoza promised in writing they would establish. All the freedoms that we recognize in democratic countries and which the Sandinistas have betrayed. Second, stopping the support for violence in Central America, which the Sandinistas began immediately upon coming to power in 1979. This includes support for the Salvadoran guerrillas, for terrorists in Honduras, in Costa Rica, and other parts. Third, the severance of military ties with Cuba and the Soviet bloc, and radical Arab states, and a lot of terrorist groups that are operating in Nicaragua today, hosted by the Sandinistas. We don't believe that their presence is conducive to peace or democracy or development in the region.
Well,
finally, the reduction of the military establishment of Nicaragua to a level of equilibrium with the rest of Central America.
Well, we agree with you on all of those goals, but you didn't really quite answer my question. The Soviet Constitution was passed in 1936 guaranteeing freedom for everybody. Suppose Stalin had said in 1937, I ask you to confide in me as a libertarian, as a constitutional libertarian. You'd have said what? You'd have said, well, I don't believe this is possible. Now, are you telling me that in your judgment, the Sandinista government is capable of promulgating these reforms?
Well, it is precisely because we don't believe that they are on their way to democracy that the president has requested of the Congress assistance to put pressures on the Sandinistas in order to bring them to the negotiating table in a mediated effort, mediated by the Catholic Church of Nicaragua, which has offered to do that, which we hope will bring about that democracy. Now, that hope, of course, has to be backed up by something, and that something has to be the necessary financial and other resources to bring the communist rulers of Nicaragua today to negotiate with their own people.
Well, what you're really saying is that you're going to force them to do that.
Unfortunately, they have not responded to any persuasion, so pressures have to be adopted.
Well, Dr. Alzugaray, is it your position that it is possible for the Sandinista government to reform?
Well, let me answer you this. 20 years ago, more than 20 years ago, in 1959, Castro took over Cuba, and then the communists came and took over Cuba. 20 years later, 1979, they took another country in Central America, Nicaragua. I don't think the story will tell us that they are not going to let it go. They are going to stay there, and they are going to continue to try to overthrow other countries. At this time, in 1985, you can find guerrillas, communist guerrillas, in almost all the countries of Latin America, from Mexico, because they have it in the Yucatan area, in a very low key, down to Argentina.
Yeah, but now let's straighten out this question. I don't think too many people question that Cuba helped the Sandinistas, but not very many people are saying that the Sandinistas are Cuban. Under the circumstances, we have to grant, do we not, an indigenous pro-Marxist element in Nicaragua. And this would be the Sandinistas, would it not?
Yes. What happened here is that they use the people. They use the people that are illiterated. They use the people that want to have liberty. When they have a dictatorship in any country, the people want freedom. The people want the United States of American image. They make propaganda. When I say they, the communists. Telling the people that they are going to have what you have here in this country, what we have here in this country. And at the end, they betray the revolution, and they start to kill the good people, and they impose a totalitarian regime. It happened in 59 in Cuba, it's happening now in Nicaragua.
Yeah, but here's what I'm terribly anxious to focus on, Mr. Reich, and I'd appreciate your giving me a hand. If I say to you, madam, I won't deal with you unless you grow a third leg, then I know I'm asking for a biological impossibility. So I may as well not say I'm going to deal with you at all, because the contingency is ruled out. We know that during the 16th century and during the 17th century, there were great religious wars fought, some of them on the basis that the target population had to change its religion. And people would say, well, it's impossible to ask these Huguenots to become Catholics, or impossible for these Jacobites to become Protestants. But nevertheless, sometimes under certain force, they did so. There's a tremendous pressure going on right now to reform the government of South Africa. Some people say it's inconceivable that these people who've been brought up on apartheid can ever be brought around to racial equality. Now, I'm asking, is all of this language aimed at reforming the Sandinistas a form of auto-hypnosis, purely to sort of tenderize the rhetoric?
No, I think it is both a recognition of the nature of the Sandinista government and...
The nature.
That's right.
The nature meaning that it's congenital?
Some of it is. The government, as you know, is in the hands of 9 individuals. They theoretically elected a president last year, but as your analogy with the Soviet constitution, I think the Nicaraguan elections had a lot to do with Eastern European elections under the communists. The 9 comandantes, the 9 rulers of the Sandinista government, are self-avowed Marxist-Leninists. But they do represent different factions that did come together under the aegis of Fidel Castro in order to ensure his continued military support for the overthrow of Somoza. We're talking about a year and a half before the overthrow of Somoza. He brought them together. So it isn't necessarily congenital. These people don't necessarily unite They may very well have different ideas of survival. They may find that it is easier for them to carry out some of the aspects of the revolution which overthrew Somoza without the imposition of a totalitarian Marxist-Leninist regime, which others want to do in Nicaragua.
So therefore, you are attempting to appeal to that faction within those nine that tends to be more moderate, hoping that it will prevail over the immoderate who are currently in control?
Well, not necessarily, because it may be that all nine are immoderate. Mm-hmm. We now have to deal with the entire government of Nicaragua. It may be, frankly, that we cannot deal with those nine individuals, but there may be other people in the government of Nicaragua, as we have seen in the last 6 years since they've been in power, that many of them have fled, many of them have defected, including two of their ambassadors to Washington and members of the government, high-ranking cabinet officials, for example, and even members of their security forces and their army have defected away from Nicaragua. So there's a great deal of discontent inside Nicaragua. What we're trying to do is help those people who feel, as we do, that the Nicaraguan Revolution was betrayed by the Sandinistas. The revolution which overthrew Somoza and promised a democracy was betrayed. And the way to do that is either through incentives or disincentives. Incentives were tried. For the first year and a half of the Sandinista government, the United States gave more money, more assistance to the Sandinistas than any other government in the world did. They did not respond. In fact, they did the opposite. They started helping the Salvadoran guerrillas carry out their violence in Salvador, and guerrillas in Honduras and terrorists in Costa Rica. They started building up the largest military force in Central America, inviting in the Soviets, the Cubans, the PLO, the Bader-Meinhof terrorists from all over the world. I think the people who are helping the Sandinistas to set up that kind of a government give you an idea of the kind of government they'd like to see in Nicaragua. What we're trying to do is prevent them from doing that. And that requires a policy consisting of both pressures and incentives. Right now, the pressures, unfortunately, because of their behavior, the pressures have the upper hand.
Mm-hmm. I had down to ask you both something you just you run constantly into people in America who say, you know, we have no proof that the Nicaraguans are helping the guerrillas in El Salvador. Do you have proof? Have you seen with your own eyes, Doctor, evidence that the guerrilla movement in Salvador is being helped by the Nicaraguans?
No, I don't work in the information department. I work as a doctor, mm-hmm. humanitarian task in Central America. You don't have to have such a proof. Getting somebody, you know, delivering the gun to the other people, to the guerrillas. They are neighbors. They have areas in the coast, in the Pacific coast, in the Gulf of Fonseca, where they made those trips with ships, and they have airdrops as well. The same way the Contras have airdrops from the Democratic friends and deliveries in the coast, the same thing they do over there from Nicaragua to El Salvador.
Who makes those jeeps?
Which one?
The ones that land with the guerrillas in
El Salvador. Nicaraguans.
Nicaraguans. Do they have jeep factories in Nicaragua?
No, but it's what I heard. It's what I heard.
Well, who if they don't make them there, where do they make them? In Cuba? Czechoslovakia?
Cuba is helping a lot. Cuba is helping and coordinating these efforts.
Well, Mr. Reich, Dr. Alzugaray begs off at this, yeah. What concrete proof would you ask somebody who was inquisitional on the subject?
There is so much evidence that the Sandinistas have been supporting the Salvadoran guerrillas from the very beginning that this is not even discussed or debated in the U.S. Congress anymore. Most members of Congress now, except of course for fringe element on one extreme, who will not be confused by the facts, recognize that the Nicaraguans, who in fact have admitted in some of the more candid moments that they do so, have supported the Salvadoran guerrillas. I personally have talked to Salvadoran guerrilla commanders who have defected. I've talked to members of the Nicaraguan government who have been at the other end of the supply pipeline. We have in the U.S. government approximately 2,000, I should say, in what the U.S. government has access to, approximately 2,000 captured weapons from El Salvador and Honduras, weapons captured from the guerrillas. Of these, about 1,200 are M16 or AR-15 automatic rifles that the United States shipped to Vietnam in the 1960s and early 70s. We have traced, through their serial numbers, these weapons to U.S. or South Vietnamese Army units.
That was a melancholy search, wasn't it?
That's right. Yeah. And we have found 70% of those M16s that have been captured in El Salvador or Honduras from communist guerrillas are traceable to United States or South Vietnamese Army units in Vietnam and were lost track of, obviously, after the North Vietnamese invasion of the South and the capture of South Vietnam by Hanoi. The next time these rifles were found, where it was in El Salvador in the 1970s or 80s, there's no possible way these rifles could have come from Vietnam to El Salvador without the help of Cuba and Nicaragua. Now, this is not just conjecture, because we also have other documents, such as the captured diary of the Secretary General of the Communist Party of El Salvador, Shafiq Handal, who came to the United States to help set up some of their support elements in this country, supporting the Salvadoran guerrillas in the propaganda war, but who also then went on to Managua, Havana, Moscow, Sofia, Bulgaria, and Hanoi, and listed in his diary the types of weapons and the types of ammunition and the quantities that the communist governments were going to provide to the Salvadoran guerrillas. So it isn't just conjecture. There's plenty of evidence. We have Bulgarian ammunition captured in El Salvador. We have Soviet hand grenade spoons. We have Soviet mortar rounds. We have, as I mentioned, the different types of weapons, North Vietnamese mortar sites.
So you say in Congress this is no longer disputed except over in the fever swamps. But how is it that you find so many liberals, this side of the asylums, who continue to reiterate that line? They want to make a Gulf of Tonkin resolution out of that, don't they? They want to say all that time.
That's right.
The Salvadorian guerrillas were in fact indigenous. Is it simply the cultivation of something they would like to believe is true?
I think
or
it's part.
Is it disinformation?
Well, it is both. I was going to say it is partly the desire on the part of some people to see Vietnam wherever there are palm trees and helicopters.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Another is frankly the result of disinformation on the part of the communist government, something they do very well, practically the only thing they do, as a matter of fact, very well. And another is, I think, the failure on the part of the U.S. news organizations and Western news organizations to report these facts with the same enthusiasm
yeah.
that they report facts that make the United States government look bad.
Yeah, yeah. Well, let me ask a point that, in a sense, is related to this. We're struggling to find out the truth. Why has the Catholic Church, or parts of the Catholic Church, been such an obstacle to the apprehension of the truth in Central America?
Well, what is happening in the Catholic Church, as you noticed, they have a lot of priests and nuns that have been infiltrated, or they are confused, let's say. There are orders which are entirely helping the communists take over in different countries. For example, you have two or three priests in Nicaragua which are holding cabinet posts at this time. And these people are from an order originated here in the United States. I think the Catholics themselves, they have to clean their house. It's very important and it's very dramatic what is going on in all the sectors of the society, of the Western society.
Now, you said that there was partly infiltration and partly self-deceit. Now, are you saying that most of the problem would go away if those orders were exposed to the truth? Or is it more complicated than that? Might they actually be edging towards that liberation theology that justifies Marxism as an anti-capitalist instrument?
That's correct. That's the problem. They have a new theory that they are trying to oppose the real Catholicism, and they are not going to believe or follow the Pope. You know that they have even tried to kill the Pope. The situation is very, very bad, and that they have very, very dirty house. They have to clean it.
Well, to what extent is this a policy objective of yours, Mr. Reich, given that the Catholic Church is often crucially relevant in Latin American affairs? To what extent have you mounted an effort to instruct Catholic observers in what is actually going on?
Well, this is, it's a very complicated and very dangerous, frankly, effort for the government to engage in anything which can be construed as criticism of any church. We have to recognize, however, that most of the Catholic Church is not engaged on this issue. And in fact, if you look at the recognized leader of the Catholic Church, His Holiness the Pope, I think there's very little question that he sides with some of the orders that Mr. Alzugaray mentioned that are actively supporting the communist government of Nicaragua. There are great divisions within the Catholic Church. There's no such thing in this debate as just one position of the church. Now, however, there are some elements within the Catholic Church, both lay and priests and nuns, who have supported either the Nicaraguan government or the Salvadoran guerrillas. I believe they are mistaken. What we simply try to do is try to point out to them what the Catholic Church, and in this case I think we can safely say most of the Catholic Church in Central America, says about the conflict in Central America. The Archbishop of Nicaragua, the Cardinal, newly named Cardinal Juan Luis Bravo, is very clear in his positions about the fact that the Sandinista government has now become worse than the Somoza dictatorship, which everybody, and practically everybody in Nicaragua, hated. The Archbishop of El Salvador, Archbishop Rivera y Damas, has been very clear, as has the newspaper Orientacion, the official publication of the Archdiocese of El Salvador, San Salvador, that the Salvadoran guerrillas, the communist guerrillas, are engaged in a war against the people of El Salvador. Somehow, some elements of the Catholic Church in the United States have elected not to listen to the people, the Catholic Church leaders who are closest to the situation in Central America. Mm-hmm. Now, it's very difficult for the government, our government, or any government, to engage, as I said, anything that implies any criticism of certainly the U.S. Church or any other, because immediately there's accusations that we're attempting to either suppress their First Amendment rights, or there's church-state conflict or whatever. The fact is that some people, and I have to emphasize some, a minority, are engaged in political activities. In my opinion, using, frankly, some of their religious occupations as more affront than anything else.
Well, if you had, say, tomorrow on Fifth Avenue, an anti-U.S. parade, one of those Central American parades where you oppose our war against the Sandinistas, probably what, a third or fourth of it, or a quarter of it would be Catholics influenced by certain orders that have preached liberation theology. That'd be approximately correct, wouldn't it? To what extent is it a conscious policy objective of our government to appeal to these people as terribly influential people and attempt to show them that all of their traditional religious values are being traduced there?
Well, you probably recall, at least 2 years ago, I think maybe more, Vice President Bush was engaged in a quite heated controversy where he was, I think, very unfairly criticized for saying something along the lines of what we've just been talking mm-hmm. about, for even daring to think about the fact that some elements of people associated with the church, or perhaps using the church as a political front, were engaged in supporting people who we now know to be communists. So, to answer your question, as I said, it is very difficult for us to engage in any kind of an educational effort, other than to point out what the Catholic Church, either in Rome or in Managua or in San Salvador or in Tegucigalpa or San Jose, by the way, all of leaders of which I have personally talked to, and say basically the same things not exactly what we're saying. They have a different perspective, but they certainly do not support the Salvadoran guerrillas or the Sandinistas. What we try to do is point out what the Catholic Church spokesman, the official spokesman, say about the conflict that is taking place in Central America. And they recognize, by the way, they recognize the basic socioeconomic problems that have led a lot of people to follow the communists. They also recognize, however, that some of these people have been duped, that that no improvement in human rights or in the living conditions of the people, certainly not in freedom, is going to come from the imposition of a communist regime. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, a lot of people in the United States are attempting to ignore what the Catholic leaders say in Central America.
Yeah. Or how much the people have suffered as a result of Sandinista activities.
Let me ask
Dr. Alzugaray, we read in the papers about $9 million going to non-military help. Does that go to people like you?
Well, not to me.
I mean people engaged in medical work.
Yes, it will be benefit to the refugees in the area of the north frontiers or north border of Nicaragua with Honduras, and the people which are actually in Costa Rica. Mm-hmm. Refugees and as well as freedom fighters. Mm-hmm. And they need it. They really need it. They have been for over a year without receiving anything. And from Miami, where I live, we have been sending them, you know, time to time, planes, load of medications, food, and clothing.
Paid by whom?
Paid by the people, of Miami.
Well, what happens to the congressional money?
Well, this has been in the last year. The congressional money is still in the Congress. They haven't given yet the money. So they are preparing a commission in order to deliver these medications, food, clothing, or whatever they are going to offer over there. But they haven't reached down there yet.
Mm-hmm. So that's simply a matter of logistics rather than political interruption?
Yeah, it's a matter of political problems too, because the Congress now didn't want the CIA or Pentagon or anybody else to deliver this material. And I think now they are getting a commission of 12 people directed through the State Department, which is going to direct and deliver this type of merchandise in the proper areas where the refugees are living now in very precarious condition.
Ms. Reich, let me ask you a question which means a great deal to me, since I was brought up by, well, my father lived in Mexico for many years, and in fact was appointed governor of Veracruz by Woodrow Wilson, a position he declined because he was always out of sympathy with any foreign interference in Latin America. So that's been sort of the tradition that I've grown to respect. Answer me this one. Since it's so clear to you, and so clear to me, and so clear to Dr. Alzugaray and so many others, that in fact the turmoil we're talking about in Nicaragua and El Salvador, in Cuba, is the direct result of Soviet intervention, why is it that we can't get Mexico, for instance, to react in the orthodox way against foreign intervention?
Well, if there's anything perhaps more difficult than state church relations to talk about, it's U.S.-Mexican relations. So I'm going to have to
take your time,
dance around the question a little bit. The fact is, if you look at the actions of the Mexican government in the last 4 years, from, for example, 1981, when they joined with the French government in recognizing the Salvadoran guerrillas as a, quote, legitimate political force, unquote, in that country, to the present time when they have recognized the government of President Duarte, sent the foreign minister to his inauguration, are providing economic assistance to that government, there has been an evolution in the attitude, I believe, of the government of Mexico, which, once again, I believe, shows or illustrates that they recognize that the problems of the region are not entirely indigenous, as was their position several years ago, that in fact there is very clear-cut Soviet, Cuban, East German, Czechoslovakian, North Vietnamese, Libyan, PLO, interference from so many other extra-continental powers or terrorist groups or political movements, that I think the Mexican government has realized that it also could be, speaking hypothetically, of course, could be the object of destabilization by some of these same elements. And perhaps some of the movement or the evolution of their policy is due to this recognition. Perhaps some of it is due to changes in personalities in the government of Mexico in the last 4 years, some of whom recognize that Castro really is up to no good in Central America, that he's not going to bring about the stability which Mexico so sorely needs for its economic development, and that the government of the United States, in fact, has had a policy aimed both at preventing the destabilization of the region, but also at helping to deal with the poverty and the malnutrition and the lack of education and lack of political freedoms and economic opportunities that have existed there.
Well, to what extent are they dominated by kind of a instinctive anti-Yankee bias, el coloso del norte, the colossus of the north? Is it that their instinctive anti-Americanism on the global scale outweighs the particularities that they see of Soviet of the neo-colonialism, which is Soviet? Is that a problem that you have to face directly?
Well, I don't know how instinctive, of course, it is, but there's no question that Mexican foreign policy has been characterized by a great willingness to show its independence of the United States, to the point where some political scientists observe that they almost always take a position apart from, if not diametrically opposed, to that of the U.S. However, I believe, once again, that that is not what we're seeing today, that the Mexican foreign policy towards Central America today is more characterized by a recognition of the real, all of the causes of the problem, the internal and the external, as the Kissinger Commission found existed, both the historical causes and the ones brought about by the external interference.
Well, if that's the case, why don't we hear more directly from the Contadora countries a denunciation of this neocolonialism of the Soviet Union?
Well, because they are all nine, well, let's say all four of the outer Contadora countries are Latin American. They have historically, over the last 150 years, looked to the United States as the big boy on the block. And it is not, for whatever reason, conducive to, it's just not in their nature, frankly, to take a position which may appear to be close to that of the United States. But if you look at the result of the Contadora deliberations, if you look at the 21 objectives that they have come up with, they include all.
They correspond.
That's right.
Yeah, but they sided with us twice rather critically. Once was against Castro, 1961. Another time against whatever you call it that was going on in the Dominican Republic in 1965.
Yes.
With the exception of Mexico, I think it was, they all endorsed the landing of the Marines there. So that are we, notwithstanding 15, 20 more years of Castro since then, losing our grip on Latin American policy, that we can't get them to side with us now?
Well, I'm not sure that we ever had such a grip, frankly.
Well,
there was no question.
They closed their gates on Castro, with the exception of Mexico.
But you remember that
the 60s.
That's right, and it was because of Castro's interference in Venezuela. Very clearly,
and
cache
Colombia
of arms was discovered, clearly traceable to Fidel Castro. And then the Latin Americans realized that what the American government had been saying for several years was indeed true, that Castro was actively engaged in destabilizing the democracies. I mean, the democracy of Venezuela at the time was supported by everyone who wished for a departure from the cycle of violence and dictatorships that had existed in that country. And yet Castro was willing to undermine that very new democracy in Venezuela.
What clearer example of that than what was done to the Sandinistas, which in the name of democracy entered Managua and instantly corrupted all of the perceived aims of that liberation movement. Who was the president of Mexico who sort of fought? Betancourt.
Betancourt was Venezuela.
Betancourt's renunciation of Castro, who had at one point been sort of a protege of his, had tremendous impact in 1960-61.
64, right.
Now, by the same token, why isn't there a president of Mexico, mutatis mutandis, taking the same position vis-a-vis the Sandinistas? Is that a failure of American diplomacy?
No, I don't believe so. I think it is. You have to look at the almost 200 years of U.S.-Mexican relations to find the answer to that. I don't believe it's, personally, that is a failure of U.S. diplomacy in this case.
And you, Doctor?
I think so. Yeah. I think so. To look back and see what was the relationship between Mexico and the United States, because we hear them talking, you know, always with some resentment about what happened years ago.
And do we answer properly? Do we answer resourcefully that charge or not?
No, sir.
We don't. And how would you improve that?
At this time?
Yes.
I really don't know. I have to continue to building up good relations, and I really don't know. I really don't know.
Well, let's submit to our examiner, Mr. Michael Kinsley, as I've said, is the editor of the New Republic. Before that, he was the editor of Harper's. Before that, he was with the New Republic. Before that, he was the Washington Monthly. Before that, he was getting a law degree at Harvard. Before that, he was studying economics at Magdalen College in Oxford. Before that, he was a student in Oxford. And before that, he was very well informed.
Anything I ever knew, I've forgotten.
Mr. Kinsley.
Both Dr. Alzugaray and Mr. Reich have used the phrase, which you hear a lot in these debates, that the Nicaraguan Sandinistas have betrayed the revolution. And this raises something that I think bothers a lot of people about the opposition to the Sandinista regime. I think most people, except for those out on this fringe you made a passing reference to, would agree that they win no prizes for compassion or humanitarianism or democracy or anything else. But I was just wondering, Dr. Alzugaray, what was your attitude towards the Somoza regime? And did you ever get involved in any humanitarian efforts on behalf of its victims?
As you remember, I came from Cuba. And before Castro took over, it was a dictatorship in my country. And as I told you, everybody was looking for the mirror of America, the liberties you have here. And everybody fight for that in life, all over the world. Everybody's looking to America. And they're looking for the help of America. What happened in Nicaragua was the same story. It was a regime of Somozas. The people didn't want it. They have some abuse, some excess. The people revolt, and they try to obtain the liberty they were thinking about. And the same thing happened that happened in Cuba.
Were you involved in any way in helping them obtain their liberty from the previous regime, or did you only get involved when the Sandinistas took over?
Well, I get involved after the communists took over, because in the other opportunity, even in Miami, we knew that many of the people who were in the junta de gobierno of the Sandinistas, they were communists. So we are a little bit hesitating to be helping people to take over the government. There were not a clear fight at that time. We were a standby, as we said. And we were trying to help the democratic forces to win, but not the communist forces.
Well, I don't want to turn the screws on Dr. Alzugaray too tight, so let me turn to Mr. Reich. One of the problems that people, not just in this country, but I think especially our allies around the world, have with American policy in Nicaragua, and I know conservatives in this country find it extremely distressing and inexplicable that our allies don't support us on this, although in general they don't, is the question, where were we during before the revolution, that was ostensibly betrayed by the Sandinistas. For four decades, the United States, you know, wasn't merely friendly with Somoza, but supported him. All his kids went to our military academies. We supplied him with military equipment. We poured in aid during the earthquake, which, of course, much of which ended up in his pockets. And I think that is a cause of a great deal of cynicism about our current mock or genuine outrage over the abuses of the Sandinistas. And isn't that a perfectly legitimate reason to be cynical or skeptical about American policy?
No, I think that there's no question that the U.S., I think, tried to help the Nicaraguans who wanted to establish a democracy in Nicaragua. Perhaps mistakes were made 50 years ago. There's no question that a lot of Nicaraguans look at it that way. If you read the book that Shirley Christian of the New York Times just wrote about Nicaragua, it shows, in fact, that Augusto César Sandino, after whom the Sandinistas are named, I think if he knew that, he might be a little bit upset, actually wanted the U.S. Marines to take over the government of Nicaragua before he would come down from the mountains, even though he'd been fighting them, because he preferred the Marines to run the elections in Nicaragua than the indigenous Nicaraguans who were then running the government. What I'm saying is that everything is relative in the world, and certainly in politics. And relative to what was there before the Marines arrived, relative to what could have happened and what was happening before they arrived, and relative, in fact, to what United States intervention, if you want to call it that, whether it's good or bad intervention, represents, I think that our role has been positive. One thing we know
even during the Somoza decades.
No, because I think that you have to understand how little we actually did support Somoza. If you look at the figures of military and economic assistance to Somoza, you'd be surprised how modest they really were. Somoza didn't need the United States to run Nicaragua. He and his family for 45 years controlled that country, frankly, without the help of the United States. One of the many myths that has developed about why the United States supported Somoza was, quote, to protect U.S. investment, unquote. As a matter of fact, Nicaragua had the smallest U.S. investment of any country in Central America. And the reason was nobody could do business with Somoza. He ran that country as his own private farm. There are a lot of misconceptions about U.S.-Nicaraguan history. And one of them is the fact that we put Somoza in power. We did not. The Marines left a year and a half before the elder Somoza took over, assassinated Sandino, and took over the National Guard. And another one is that we therefore don't have the moral rights to criticize a terrible wrong which is being done to the people of Nicaragua who did overthrow a 45-year-long dictatorship, but not to have another one imposed on them.
But it is not a myth that we did, to whatever extent or to whatever effectiveness, support Somoza and have very friendly relations with Somoza.
Well, those are two different things. Yes, we have friendly relations with Somoza. We also, frankly, in the late 1970s, if you read the history,
Too late.
Could be. I think you're going to have to address those criticisms to the Carter administration, which was then in power.
You would criticize the Carter administration for failing to betray Somoza earlier?
Not failing to betray Somoza.
Failing to give Somoza a push before they finally got around to it.
No, for failing to find a democratic alternative to Somoza earlier. I mean, if the United States influence was as great as you say it is, then why couldn't even the Carter administration find a way to do it?
I think Mr. Carter was too busy finding a democratic alternative to the Shah, don't you?
Yeah, well, there's analogies there. Should we have propped him up longer, or should we have pushed him out earlier?
Just heard Mr. Reich that we weren't propping him up.
What?
Have you forgotten that?
I haven't forgotten it.
We weren't propping him up. We weren't helping Nicaragua.
Unless
you say
that
because we permitted his son to go to West Point, that was help. But we permitted anybody's son to go there.
It was a perception throughout the world, and not one based on utter myth and fantasy.
It was based on our hospitality in the late 20s. But since then, the Somocistas were pro-American, that's true. And I know that gets all liberals itchy. There must be something wrong with anybody who's pro-American. But in fact, we weren't. We weren't helping Somoza in any way.
Not to the extent that we propped him up. Not to the extent that we were the reason why Somoza stayed in power and why the family ran the country for 45 years. There's a larger issue here, which concerns me a great deal as a student of Latin American development, which is my field, which is that Americans tend to have this guilt feeling about what we have done in Latin America, and it exonerates, frankly, the Latin Americans themselves from any responsibility for the actions and for the events that take place in their own country. What happened in Nicaragua was a result of the actions of Nicaraguans. They put Somoza in power. They kept Somoza in power. Now, they may have been bad Nicaraguans. I don't know. The fact is, I think that the majority of the people didn't fare well under Somoza. I'm not saying that. But there's a danger in blaming ourselves, our government or our people or our society, for the ills of other countries when that is exaggerated.
Well, the question is not, was Somoza utterly dependent on us, but did we endorse his regime, which I think until the end of the 70s, for all practical purposes, we did.
What is the ritual by which we endorse regimes?
Well, I think it's more easy to define the ritual by which we unendorse regimes, as President Reagan has clearly done with the Sandinistas. There are methods of distancing yourself from governments you don't like, even if you're not taking any effective action to do anything about it. And I think that is a method of dues paying that gives you the bona fides later on. And if we had done with Somoza what Reagan is doing now, purely rhetorically, leaving apart the aid of the Contras with the Sandinistas, we would have not merely would we be in a better moral position, which people might regard as a trivial reason to do anything, but we would have the support of our allies now, I think, possibly. Mr. Buckley, do you support the aid to the Contras, U.S. government aid to the Contras?
Oh, yes, I certainly do.
So it doesn't violate your father's injunctions against interference with foreign
countries? No, because my father also believed in the Monroe Doctrine, as do I. You could ask me a tough one by saying, would I support the Contras if it were purely an indigenous dictatorship? Would I support aid to the Contras against Pop or Baby Doc? That's a rough one, because
go ahead.
Well, it's a rough one because, I'm very much influenced by the Fulbright codicil that says you don't officially pick quarrels with countries that aren't attempting to export their dictatorship, otherwise it would simply exhaust your resources. But I think I should confess this, I'm much less anti-imperialist than I used to be, because I think anti-imperialism is kind of a lazy sanction for an energetic society to take. It's one thing to be anti-imperialist and then permit 2 million Cambodians to get slaughtered. Even George McGovern, half asleep, woke up one day and said, why aren't we stopping it? Forgetting that he had laid the entire groundwork for a kind of moral isolationism over the preceding decade.
Well, that was just a preliminary, really, to what I really... I have here in my hand, as a friend of yours used to say, a newspaper clip.
No, you would say a photostatic copy of it.
Well, I have the original.
You've forgotten your Joe McCarthy.
It's one of many concerning, to make a long story short, Contra atrocities. And it's a story the week before we taped the show about how they went into a village in central Nicaragua where previously they hadn't been. And rounded up all the town, officials of the town, took all but one of them out, one who the people said was friendly or for whatever reason, shot them, left them lying on the ground. Now, I bring this up for two reasons. First of all, to make the obvious point, Dr. Alzugaray has been down delivering medical aid to people who've been harmed by the Sandinistas. I want just the obvious point that in a war, there are death and misery on both sides, but more importantly, I'd just like to pose the question, possibly to Mr. Buckley, what are the rules in this game we're playing down there? Would it be acceptable, and if not, why not, for, say, a Nicaraguan-financed squads to march into a small town in Ohio and line up all the officials and shoot them?
Well, that was a source of public discussion a year ago. You remember when the so-called CIA directive became an issue in the campaign, said directive having prescribed and authorized and described all kinds of operational tactics that are pretty horrifying to read about. I maintain a schizophrenic position on these. It seems to me that one distinguishes between a bullet aimed at a tyrant and a bullet aimed at an innocent resident of a town. There's no way in which the Contras can be military effective without shooting people. And there's no way in which you can always land your bullet exactly into the heart of the tyrant. You're going to miss some. We missed some of the American Revolution. I don't see how techniques have improved in the last 200 years, sorry.
I'd like to say a couple of things about that, because I think it is very important, and because it goes to the heart of the debate of who are we supporting in this battle in Central America. If the people we're supporting are as bad as the ones that we're opposing, I think is implied in your question, and why do we take sides?
No, well, that's I'm just
first. You have, to, I think, we as Americans should oppose violations of human rights, no matter who carries them out.
But is war a violation of human rights?
No, violations of human rights. No, I'm not talking about combat casualties. I'm talking about taking somebody out.
But he is.
Yes, I am talking about. I'm saying, are we in a war with Nicaragua? And if we are, do they have the right to fight back? And if not, why not?
I'm not talking about somebody who was wounded or killed in battle. I mean, that does happen in war. But you're implying, at least this article that you quote says, that the Contras purposely identified some people, took them out, and executed them. The fact is that we don't really know what is happening in that area of human rights in Nicaragua for several reasons.
First, do you disbelieve the New York Times?
I have in the past.
Oh, not on this program.
As a matter of fact. And by the way, since you mentioned the New York Times, there was a famous case not too long ago about El Salvador, about an alleged atrocity committed in front of American soldiers. This is very important because you quote the New York Times. And I maintain that the U.S. media has had a double standard here. About covering human rights violations by people associated with the United States versus those that are opposed to the United States, and that the New York Times finally recognized 4 months after the fact they should not have run that story because that story was not.
Well, but look, there have been, this is, as I said, one of many stories that are all very similar, and as Mr. Buckley points out, what are you supposed to do when you're fighting?
Well, let me tell you what you do. You try to find out. There are recognized human rights commissions. It's interesting to note that the last two heads of the government-controlled Human Rights Commission in Nicaragua have defected away from Nicaragua. And one of them just recently told us and told other people in the United States that he left, among other things, because the Sandinistas were manipulating human rights stories such as this, that they did not allow even their own controlled Human Rights Commission to investigate human rights violations by the Sandinistas. And furthermore, this is very important, that they were supported by and supporting Americans who were coming down to prove that the Contras were terrible and they were worse, in fact, than the Sandinistas, in order to undermine the support of the American people for the Contras.
Well, so what? The question is, if these stories are true, is there any reason why the Nicaraguans would be forbidden under the rules of whatever game we're playing here, if you call it terrorism, you call it war, whatever, to do the same in our country? That's the question I'm posing.
Well, if you're saying that if you authorize George Washington to fight the British oppressors, then you, by the same token, authorize anybody else to fight anybody else, you're missing out the distinctive characteristic, which is that there are a class of oppressors and a class of non-oppressors.
Okay, so the difference. The
people who are fighting the Sandinista are the idealists.
Okay, that's fine.
Fighting,
and they're Nicaraguans.
John Stuart Mill was very plain when he said, "On an oppressive society, a tyrant can be tolerated provided he is working towards liberalization."
All right, look, this is good. This is what I was hoping we would get to. So the difference between our people that we're funding going in, lining up a bunch of Sandinistas and shooting them, and the Sandinistas sending a crowd of people over to Canton, Ohio, and do the same thing to the mayor and the city council, is that we're the good guys and they're the bad guys.
Right.
Well, all right. That brings me to the question.
Next question?
Yes.
I have a question. Who are these people that the Sandinistas would be sending to Canton, Ohio?
Terrorists.
Are they Americans?
Terrorists.
American terrorists, you're saying. Because you got to remember that the people who you say
they find some of these nuns you don't like, and they give them machine guns and send them to Canton, Ohio, I want to press Mr. Buckley on this, because I think we're getting somewhere.
And we increase the list of martyrs.
The only difference is the ends, not the means.
Well,
at least within this framework.
The most highly trammeled cliche in America is that the end justifies the means. The proper statement is, does the end justify any means?
No.
Does the end justify any means is the correct statement. Because obviously, the ends justify means.
Right.
A lost Coca-Cola justifies a paramilitary effort. Right. An atom bomb does not, necessarily. So the question is, are any means justified for certain ends? The answer is no.
Well, here's what I want.
Not every means is justified.
How would you define terrorism? And can you define it in a way that would include the people we're against and not include the people we're for, such as the Contras? I think that because the notion of terrorism, which this administration and many others has made such an enormous deal about, is premised on precisely the idea that no matter what the ends, there are some means that are invalid. And they have had no compunction whatsoever about calling the guerrillas in El Salvador terrorists, who are doing approximately the same things that the Contras are doing.
Well, when the resistance in France was fighting to free, liberate France from the Nazi oppressors, they engaged in certain acts that formally, before a duly constituted tribunal, might be denounced as terroristic. That is to say, they would actually shoot somebody, hoping to get somebody who was close to the mayor, who was cooperating with the authorities. Those, however, it seems to me, would be more forgivable than the identical act being performed by people whose motives were to advance the causes of the Nazis. And I think that's terribly important to take into account when you make moral adjudications, don't you?
I agree. And what you're saying, in effect, is that the act of violence is the same whether it's carried out by the Salvadoran guerrillas or the Contras. Well, by that standard, then, when Hitler invaded Poland, he was engaging in about the same act that we were engaged in on June 6, 1944.
I'm not the one who's making the big deal about terrorism. It's your State Department that's carrying on about terrorism. And for example, a State Department memo recently is proposing to spend $53 million for anti-terrorist, so quote-unquote, efforts in Central America. And this includes things like funding the El Salvador Army, which has committed various atrocities, but is the Army. And my question is...
Your question was, thank you very much, Mr. Michael Kinsley.
I didn't really have a question. I just wanted to make that point.
Author of the syndicated column TRB from Washington. And thank you very much, Mr. Otto Reich of the State Department, and thank you, Dr. Alzugaray, and thank you, ladies, some of you from the Stein Senior Center.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations. Dow Chemical Company, the Mobil Corporation, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Atlantic Richfield, and the Friends of Firing Line. This program was produced by SICA, which is solely responsible for its content. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $3 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250.